भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। नारायणं नमस्कृत्यं नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासां ततो जयमुदीरये। नष्टप्रायेषु पत्रेषु नित्यं भागवतसेवया भगवति उत्तमश्लोके भक्तिर्भवति नैष्ठिकी। कृष्णाय वासुदेवाय देवकी नन्दनाय च नन्दगोपकुमाराय गोविन्दाय नमो नमः। आनन्दलीलामय विग्रहाय हेमाङ्गदिव्या च वीसुन्दराय तस्मै महाप्रेमरसप्रदाय श्रीचैतन्यचन्द्राय नमो नमस्ते। आराध्य भगवान् व्रजेशतनयस्तद्धाम वृन्दावनम् रम्या काचित् उपासना व्रजवधू वर्गेण वाकल्पिता। श्रीमद्भागवतं प्रमाणममलं प्रेमापमार्थो महान् श्रीचैतन्यमहाप्रभोर्मदमिदं तत्राधारमानपरः। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे कृष्ण। इन लास्ट सेशन वी हैव डिस्कस्ड द फर्स्ट मीटिंग बिटवीन श्री सार्वभौम भट्टाचार्य एंड चैतन्य महाप्रभु। एंड आफ्टर दैट मीटिंग when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went to take rest at his place that was given by or allocated by Sarvam Bhattacharya, then Gopinath Acharya and Sarvam Bhattacharya, they started discussion about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Who is he? And Gopinath Acharya, he was explaining that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is none other than the Lord. Sarvam Bhattacharya was not ready to accept it. And few of his disciples, they started putting forward different arguments. So today we will discuss about how Gopinath Acharya, he refuted the arguments that were forward by the disciples of Sarvam Bhattacharya. And the first thing that he says, that unless and until one is blessed by the Lord's mercy, it's not possible to understand the Lord. It's very important. Because most of the people, atheistic mostly, they try to see God and they demand from the people who believe in the God that show us your God. For those people, this particular conversation is a big slap on their face. Because as he says, that Ishwarera Kripalesha Hayata Yahare Seita Ishwara Tattva Janibir Pare. Gopinath Acharya says, if one receives but a tiny bit of the Lord's mercy and by dint of the devotional service, the person can understand the Lord, not by anything else. And then he quotes from the Srimad Bhagavatam, the prayers, those are offered by Brahmaji. In the 14th chapter, Brahmaji says,
अथापि ते देव पराम्बुजद्वय प्रसाद लेशानुग्रहितयेव हि जानाति तत्त्वं भगवन् महिम्नो न चान्यो कोऽपि चिरां विचिन्त्वा. He says that अथापि ते देव पराम्बुजद्वय Prasad lesha anugrahita evahi. Oh my Lord, unless and until one is blessed by the mercy of yours, it's not possible to develop attachment to your lotus feet. So everything happens by the mercy of the Lord. And who is the personification of Lord's mercy? Yes, devotees. Devotees are the personification of Lord's mercy. So when one comes in contact with devotees, he associates with them and discuss about the Supreme Personality of a Godhead, then it's possible to understand the God. Then he says, यद्यपि जगत गुरु तमी शास्त्र ज्ञानवान पृथ्वी ते नहीं पंडित तुम्हार समान. He says, you are a scholar, no doubt about that. And no one is on the earth as scholar as you. ईश्वर कृपालेश नहीं कत्वमाते अतेव ईश्वर तत्व नापार जानते. He says, even though you are a big scholar, but you don't have a mercy of the Lord. And that's why you can't understand. So now the question comes, in last session already we discussed that, who is Sarvam Bhattacharya? They have given him a title, Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya. What does it mean by Sarvabhaum? Actually, the Sarvabhaum means he's like a controller of whole earth. And he is a Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya. He is the biggest scholar on the earth at that time. Being such a great scholar who is having thousands of Vedanta Acharya disciples, not only disciples, but the Acharyas, those are those disciples like who are the Acharyas in the Vedanta. And he was training big, big sannyasis into Advaita Vedanta. And Gopinath Acharya says, you don't have mercy of God. So, what that means? The previous verse, what we have discussed about Brahmaji's prayers, what Brahmaji says? The person who renders devotional service, he gets the mercy of the Lord, and by that mercy, he gets attached to the Lord and he get to know the Lord. So not necessary that you should be a Pandit, then only you can know the Lord. Here is the biggest Pandit of that time. Gopinath Acharya says, you don't have mercy of the Lord. तुम्हारा नहीं का दोष शास्त्र यही कहे पांडित्याद ये ईश्वर तत्व ज्ञान कबू नहे. It's very easy to understand actually. He says that it's not your fault. This is what the scripture says, because only by Panditya you can't get the knowledge about the Absolute.
And not only Gopinath Acharya, but in several places in the Vedic scripture, especially in Upanishads, it is mentioned. Like in Kathopanishad, the first part, second chapter, 23rd verse, it says that, Nayam matva pravachani na labhyo na medhaya na bahuna shrute yam evaisha vrunate tena labhyas tenaishi atma vrunate tanum swa. Not just by hearing about or not by our own medhya or my intelligence or reading so many scriptures, we will understand a lot. It's not possible. After hearing that, Sarma Bhattacharya, he says, be careful what you are talking about. Acharya kaha savadhani, tomate ishvara kripa ithe ki pramani. Okay, you say that I don't have mercy of the Lord. But how do you can prove that you got the mercy of? Then Gopinath Acharya says, Vastu Vishaya Haya Vastu Jnana Vastu Tattva Jnana Haya Kripate Pramani. Knowledge of the Absolute Truth is evidence of the mercy of the Supreme Lord, Supreme Personality of God. If someone knows about the Lord, that itself shows that that person has a mercy of the Lord. Because in Bhagavad Gita, which is spoken by the Lord Himself, in 7th chapter, 25th verse, what He says, Naham Prakasha Sarvasya Yoga Maya Samapata Mudo Ayam Navijanati Lokomam Ajapaya. He is not revealed to each and everyone. Because most of the mudas, and who are mudas? Mudas are those, not necessarily they should be demonian, who are bahirmukh. Who are trying to find happiness in material world. Who are covered by the bahiranga shakti of the Lord, the external energy. And then further he says, Ihara Sharire Sabha Ishwarera Lakshana Maha Prema Vesha Tumi Panchana Darshana. He says, when you saw Lord Chaitanya first time, you have seen all the Lakshanas, the symptoms that Mahapurusha has. But still you are not able to understand that he is a Lord. Because those are the symptoms only shown by the Lord Himself, not by anyone else. Tabuta Ishwara Jnana Nahaya Tomar Ishwara Maya Yei Bali Vyavahar. He says that after seeing those symptoms also, you are not able to understand Him as a Lord. This is not but the influence of the external. When someone comes under the influence of material energy of the Lord, he becomes muda. He becomes illusioned. Muda means the person who is in illusion, who has fooled or illusioned by the illusory energy of the Lord. Dekhinana dekhetare bahirmukha jana shuni hasi sarvabhoma balila vachan. Gopinath Acharya says, a person influenced by the external energy is called Bahirmukh, a mundane person, because despite his perception, he cannot understand the real substance. See, there are many people, they come to temple, they claim themselves as a devotee. But in Bhagavad Gita, Lord says that Esham tu vandagatam papam jananam punya karmana te dvandva moha nirmukta bhajati mamana. Who are those who really worship the Lord? Esham tu antagatam papam means who has done pious activities in his previous life and who has got rid of all sinful reactions of his past life. Such a punya karma, such a pious person becomes freed from duality. So what is this duality actually? The main thing is kama and krodha. Because these are the contaminations about what Lord speaks in Bhagavad Gita. So when one gets rid of his impious activities and who is a pious, so it shows that who is pious? The person who is freed from kama and krodha, lust and anger. These are the root cause of our bondage in this material. And the person who is freed from that, bhajate mam ananyam, he worships the Supreme Personality of God. And how he worships? Ananya, without deviating himself or his mind from Lord's lotus. Make sense? Then Sarvam Bhattacharya says, see, don't get angry. It's just our discussion as a friend. You don't have to get angry and disturbed, you know. We are just discussing. And then Sarvam Bhattacharya also says, yeah, I have seen the symptoms of Mahabhagavat in Lord Chaitanya. Mahabhagavata haya Chaitanya Gosai yei kali kale Vishnura avatar nai. Yeah, I can understand he's a Mahabhagavat or great person who has all the great qualities. But as far as my knowledge goes, there is no incarnation of Lord in this age of a Kali. Then what basis you are claiming that he is Lord? So this is the way that you should make inquiry. Even though Sarvam Bhattacharya was the greatest scholar, but he is putting forward the question in a such a way that he don't want to hurt the person who is giving answer. Atayeva triyuga kari kahi Vishnu naam Kaliyuge avatar nahi shastre ratnya. See, Lord is explained in the Vedas as a Triyugi who has appeared in three yugas. So, where is the evidence in the scriptures? Then, answer to this question, Gopinath Acharya, he says, शास्त्रज्ञ करीन तुम्ही कर अभिमान सुनिए आचार्य कहे दुखी हना न मने. He says, if I tell you, don't get angry. I know you are well read scholar, but still you don't know everything. भगवत भागवत भारत दुई शास्त्रेर प्रधान सेई दुई ग्रंथ वाक्य नाही अवधान. So here he says that there are two books that is considered as the evidence for any arguments actually. One is Srimad Bhagavatam and second is Mahabharata. It's stated that the Lord appears directly. But you say that this age there is no manifestation or incarnation of Vishnu.
Kali Yuga Lilavatara Nakare Bhagavan Atayeva Triyuga Kari Kahi Tarana.
In this age of Kali, there is no Leela avatar of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Therefore, he is known as a Trayuga. That is one of his holy names.
In previous discussion also, with Sanatana Goswami Pad, Mahaprabhu says that Leela avatar Krishnera na jaye ganan pradhana kariya kahi digdarshan.
There he says to Sanatana Goswami that there are many or innumerable incarnations of the Lord. But I'm going to speak only the chief one, the most prominent incarnations. And then he says, Pratiyuge Karen Krishna Yuga Avatar Tarkanishta Ridhaya Tomar Naika Vichar.
There is a certainly an incarnation in every yuga, and such an incarnation is called the Yuga Avatar. But your heart has become so hardened by the logic and argument that you cannot consider all these facts.
Asan Varnastra Yohiyasya Grihanoto Anuyugam Tanaho Shuklo Raktastata Pita Idanim Krishnatam Gataha.
This verse was spoken by Gargacharya. Gargacharya, when he came for the name giving ceremony for the Lord, that time he told Nanda Maharaj, Nanda Maharaj, in the past, your son had bodies of three different colors according to the age. These colors were white, red, and yellow. And in this age, Dwapar Yuga, he has accepted a blackish body. So how many colors he has explained about? That means Lord is appeared in four yugas.
Iti Dwapar Uru Isha Stunvandi Jagatishwaram Nana Tantra Vidhanena Kalau Api Tathashunu.
In the age of Kali, as well as in Dwapar Yuga, the people offer prayers to the Supreme Personality of the Godhead by various mantras and observes the regulative principles of supplementary Vedic literatures. Now please hear of this from me. This quotation is from 11th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, where the Navayogendras are discussing with Maharaj Nim. And there they say is that Lord appears in Dwapar and Kali Yuga also. So what is that specific incarnation of the Lord in the age of Kali? That has been described in the 11th canto, 5th chapter and 32nd verse.
Krishna Varanam Atusha Krishna Sango Pangastra Parshadi Yadnei Sangirtano Prayer Yajandi Asumedasaha.
In this age of Kali, those who are intelligent perform a congregational chanting of the Hare Krishna Mahamantra, worshipping the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who appears in the age always describing the glories of Krishna. That incarnation is yellowish in hue and is always associated with a plainly expansion such as Nityananda Prabhu and personal expansion such as Gadadhara, as well as his devotees and associates such as Swarup Damodara.
Suvarana varana himanga varanga varanga shandanam gari sanyasa gata shanto nishta shanti parayanaha.
This verse is from Vishnu Sahasranam from Mahabharata.
And that also says that Suvarna Varuna Himango Varangashchandana. The Lord in the incarnation as a Gaur-Sundara has a golden complexion. Indeed, his entire body, which is very nicely constituted, is like a molten gold. Sandalwood pulp is smeared all over his body. He will take the fourth order of spiritual life, sannyasa, and will be very much self-controlled. He will be distinguished from the Mayavadi sannyasis in that he will be fixed in devotional service and will spread the Sankirtana movement.
Tomaryageta kathara nahi prayojan ushara bhumite yena vijara ropan.
He said, explaining you all this is of no use. It's like the sowing the seeds in the barren land. Whom is saying that? Because the Jnana Kanda or Jnana Yoga that makes your heart hard. Generally we say due to the drought, earth becomes very hard. There is no moisture at all. And if you sow something, it's not going to germinate anything, because it's too dry. So same way, knowledge makes us dry. And that's why he says it's like a sowing the seed in the barren land.
Tomare ye shishya kahe kutark nana vaad ihar ki dosh yehi mayara prakash.
This your disciples, they are putting forward some arguments, but it's not their mistake. It's the effect of the external potency of the Lord, because that's what keeps the living entity in this material world. Then he says that
yascha shaktyopi vadatam vadinim vai vivadah samvada bhuto bhavanti kurvanti chaisham muhur atma muh tasmai namo anant gunaya bhune.
Actually, this was the prayer offered by Prajapati in the sixth canto of Shrimad Bhagavatam, where he says, I offer my respectful obeisances unto the Supreme Personality of the Godhead, who is full of unlimited qualities and whose different potencies bring about agreement and disagreement between despondents. Thus the illusory energy again and again covers the self-realization of both despondents.
This is what happens, you know? If someone becomes more and more attached to the logics, and through the logics they want to understand, then the illusory energy of the Lord, she keeps him moving around, and they were not able to get to the point. They beat around the bush. Then further he says,
yuktam cha santi sarvatra bhashante brahmana yatha mayam madiyam ugrahya vadatam kimnu durkatam. Actually, this was spoken by the Lord himself to Uddhava. And he says that in almost all cases, whatever learned Brahmana speaks becomes accepted. Nothing is impossible for one who takes shelter of my illusory energy and speaks under her influence. And that's why, see, there are so many paths, you know, to go to the Lord. Because Lord, he gives everyone chance according to the development of their consciousness. And that's why we have so much of diversities, especially in India, for regarding worshipping Lord.
Tabe Bhattacharya kahe yaha gosai rasthane
हमारे नामे गुण सहित कर निमंत्रणे। After hearing this from Gopinath Acharya, Sarvam Bhattacharya said, first go to the place where Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is staying and invite him here with his associate. Ask him on my account. Prasada ani tare karah age bhiksha paschate asi amare karaiye shiksha. Take Jagannath Prasad and first give it to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his associate. After that, come back here and teach me well. Gopinath Acharya was brother-in-law of Sarvam Bhattacharya. Therefore, their relationship was very sweet and intimate. Under the circumstances, Gopinath Acharya taught him by sometimes blaspheming him, sometimes praising him, and sometimes laughing at him. This had been going on for some time. Then Mukundatta felt very satisfied to hear the conclusive statements of Gopinath Acharya. But he became very unhappy and angry to hear the statements put forward by the Sarvam Bhattacharya. According to the instructions of Sarvam Bhattacharya, Gopinath Acharya went to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and invited him on behalf of Bhattacharya. Then they went and they discussed everything. Whatever Bhattacharya has said to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he said, Amaprati Bhattacharya Haya Anugraha. See, this is what Vaishnava's heart. Mahaprabhu is showing it by his own behavior. He says that, do not speak like that. Sarvam Bhattacharya has shown great affection and mercy toward me. Amara sannyasa dharma chahin rakshite vatsalya karuna karen ki dosha. I think like a fatherly figure, he has He's trying to protect my sannyas dharma. I should not offend him. Bhattacharya sangetara mandire aila prabhura asana diya apane vasila. So one day Mahaprabhu, after going to Jagannath temple, came to Sarvam Bhattacharya's place. Being a grahastha, Sarvam Bhattacharya gave him a asana on the raised platform. Even though with age, he was like father of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. But still, being a grahastha and Mahaprabhu as a sannyasi, he gave him a sit on the raised platform. And he sat down. And then he said, Vedanta padite tabe arambha karila snehe bhakti kari kichu prabhura kahila. He then began to instruct Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu on Vedanta philosophy. And out of affection and devotion, he spoke to the Lord as follows. Vedanta shravanaye sannyasi radharma nirantara karatumi Vedanta shravana. He says that hearing Vedanta philosophy is a sannyasi's main business. Therefore, without hesitation, you should study Vedanta. And then Mahaprabhu said, Prabhu kahe more tumi kara anugraha sei se kartavya tumi yehi mora kaha. You are very merciful to me and therefore I think it is my duty to obey your order. Shatadina pariyantayche karina shravana satadina pariyantayche karina shravana Bhalamanda nahi kahe vashi matra shunya. For 7 days continuously, Sarvam Bhattacharya was speaking on Vedanta and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was sitting very quietly and very attentively he is hearing to him. But he was not responding generally, like you are hearing now. So when I look at you, then you shake your. But Mahaprabhu was quietly just sitting peacefully and hearing. So after seeing that, on the eighth day, Sarvam Bhattacharya said, are you able to understand what I'm saying? Because for last 7 days I'm speaking, but neither you're so silent that neither you put any question or you never argued for anything. So are you able to understand what I'm saying? Then Mahaprabhu said, Murkha mean nahi adhyayan. Tomara adnyate matra kariyasha. Hey, I am a fool and consequently I do not study the Vedanta Sutra. I am just trying to hear it from you because you have all of me. Sanyasira dharma lage shravan matra kari. Tumi yai artha kara puja hite na bhari. Only for the sake of executing the duties of renounced order of sannyasa do I listen. Unfortunately, I cannot in the least understanding the meaning you are processing or you are presenting. He said, I'm just hearing that, but I'm not understanding anything, what the meaning that you have derived, how you are coming upon. Bhattacharya said, Na bhujibe hena jnana yara, bhujibara lagesneha puche punabar. I accept that you do not understand, yet even one who does not understand inquires about the subject matter. When someone wants to study something, then he need to ask question. If you don't understand, you should ask. But he said, you are not asking at all. What's the problem? Tumi shuni shuni raha mauna matra dhari hridaye ki ache tomar bujhete na bari. You are hearing again and yet you keep silent. I cannot understand what actually is within your heart. See, Lord is very kautuki. You know, he always notorious. He likes to act. Then Prabhu kahe, Sutrera artha bhujiya nirmana. I can understand the Brahma Sutra. But tomara vakya shuni mana nai na avikar. But your commentary on Brahma Sutra, I am not able to understand. And neither my mind is ready to understand. Sutrera artha bhashya kahe prakashya. Tumi bhashya kaha sutrera artha achadiya. Generally, someone gives his purpose to make understand the subject matter. But your commentary on the sutras is covering the real meaning of sutra. So it's big blow to Sarvam Bhattacharya that he is a Bhattacharya, that I'm Sarvam. On top of that, he is a Vedanta teacher. And Mahaprabhu says sutras are very easy to understand. But your commentary on the sutras is covering the real meaning of the sutras. Sutrera mukhya artha na karaha vyakhyan. Kalpanarthe tumi taha kara achhadan. You do not explain the direct meaning of the Brahma Sutras. Indeed, it appears that your business is to cover their real meaning. Upanishad shabdiyei mukhya artha hai. Sei artha mukhya vyasa sutre sabakai. Then Mahaprabhu said, the Vedanta Sutra is the summary of the all Upanishads. Therefore, whatever direct meaning is there in the Upanishad is also recorded in the Vedanta Sutras or Vyasa Sutras.
मुख्य अर्थ छाड़िया कर गौण अर्थ कल्पना अभिद वृत्ति छाड़ी कर शब्देर लक्षण।
See, these are the technical words. When generally two scholars, they speak about the philosophy, then these words, they are not commonly used.
For each sutra, the direct meaning must be accepted without interpretation. However, you simply abandon the direct meaning and proceed with your imaginative interpretations.
This is pradhan, means main or mukhya artha. You kept that aside and you started giving your chaya kalpana. This is abhasa.
Then he says, Jivera asti vishtha dui shankha gomar. Shruti vakya sei dui mahapavitra hai.
See, according to Vedic system, if someone touches dead person's bone or any living entities, any living entity who is dead, his bones and his excreta, then it is considered that is most inauspicious. But Shankha and Goma, Shankha means concha, and Goma means cow dung. So both are like, one is excreta and second is like a dead shell, you know, it's like a bone. And they are considered most auspicious. How to understand that? Mahaprabhu is explaining that. No need to speculate.
स्वत प्रमाण वेद सत्य यही कर लक्षण करिले स्वतः प्रामाण्य हानि है। The Vedic statements are self-evident. Whatever is stated there must be accepted. If we interpret according to our own imagination, the authority of the Vedas is immediately lost. These are Vedic mantras, so accept them as it is without giving your own interpretation on that. What interpretation you can give? Conchal and cowdung. It's Vedavakya. No need to prove that. That's why generally when previously us well-cultured people used to fight. If someone says something, then hey, is it Vedavakya or what? This is what Veda says, that I should listen to you. So for us, Pramana means, evidence means Veda. So Vedas, whatever they say, we accept as it is. No need to argue or no need to give interpretation of that. Vyasa Sutra Artha Yaiche सूर्येर किरण स्वकल्पित भाष्येन मेघे करे आच्छादन।
Then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu continued, the Brahma Sutras compiled by Vyasadevas is as radiant as the sun. One who tries to interpret its meaning simply covers the sunshine with a cloud. So someone who tries to give his comments on the Vedic text, so he's like trying to cover the real meaning of that verse.
Veda Purane kahe Brahma Nirupan Sei Brahma Brihad Vastu Ishvara Lakshan. All the Vedas and literatures are strictly followers. The Vedic principles explain that Supreme Brahman is absolute truth, the greatest of all and a feature of a Supreme Lord.
Sarva Aishwarya Paripurna Swayam Bhagavan Tare Nirakara Kari Karaha Vyakhyam. Actually, the Supreme Absolute Truth is a person, the Supreme Person of Godhead, full with all appearances. And you are trying to explain him and impersonal and formless.
Nirvishesha tare kahe yehi shruti gan prakrita nishedhi kare aprakrita sthapan.
Wherever there is an impersonal description in the Vedas, the Vedas means to establish that everything belongs to the Supreme Personality of Godhead, is transcendental and free from mundane characteristics.
See, there are many impersonal statements in Upanishads when it speaks about the Supreme Personality of Godhead.
So, for example, apani pado javan grahito vashyasta akush chakshu chushrunayo akarnaha saveti vedyam najatasyeti vetta tam ahur argyam purusham mahant.
Although the Supreme Lord is described as having no hands and legs, he nonetheless accepts all sacrificial offerings. He has no eyes, yet he sees everything. He has no ears, yet he hears everything. When it is stated that the Supreme Lord has no hands, no legs, one should not think that he is impersonal. Rather, he has no mundane hands and legs like ours. He has no eyes, yet he sees. This means that he does not have mundane limited eyes like ours. Rather, he has such eyes that he can see past, present and future. Everywhere, in every corner of the universe and in every corner of the heart of every living entity. Thus, the impersonal description in the Vedas intended to deny mundane characteristics of the Supreme Lord. They do not intend to establish the Supreme Lord is impersonal. Then further, Mahaprabhu says here, yaya stutir jalpati nirvishesham sa shabdi hante sa vishesham eva vichara yoge satyam tatasam rayo baliha sa vishesham eva. Then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, whatever Vedic mantras describe the absolute truth impersonally only prove in the end that the absolute truth is a person. The Supreme Lord is understood in two features, impersonal and personal. If one considers the Supreme Personality of a Godhead in both features, he can actually understand the absolute truth. He knows that the personal understanding is stronger because we see that everything is full of variety. No one can see anything that is not full of variety.
Brahma haite janme vishwa bhramete jivaya sei brahme punarapi haye yaya laya.
Everything in the cosmic manifestation emanates from the absolute truth, remains in the absolute truth, and after annihilation again enters the absolute truth.
As explained in Taittiriya Upanishad, imani bhutani jayate, from him all the living entity comes.
So he is the source of everything.
And Lord also, aham sarvasya prabho matta sarva pravartate.
I'm the Lord and everything manifests from him, from me.
So he is a person and from him everything that manifests. Whether it is a person, whether it is impersonal.
Apadana karana adhikarana karakatina bhagvanera swashi swavisheshe yaitina chinna.
So it is, now he is technically making him understand that the personal features of the Supreme Personality of Godhead are categorized in three cases, namely ablative, instrumental and locative. Apadan, Karan and Adhikaran.
So Bhaktivinoda Thakur in his Amrit Prabhav Bhashya, he says that according to the injunction of Upanishadas, the Supreme Absolute Truth is he from whom everything emanates.
It is understood that whole cosmic manifestation emanated from Brahman, the Supreme Absolute Truth. The creation subsists by the energy of the Supreme Brahman and after annihilation merges into the Supreme Brahman. From this, we can understand that Absolute Truth can be categorized in threes: ablative, instrumental, and locative. According to these three cases, the Absolute Truth is positively personified. In this connection, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, he quotes from Aitariya Upanishad, Atma vairam yeka yuvagra asin nanyat kanchin mishattat illakshanam lokat nirsajatiti. Then he again quotes from Shweta Shvatara Upanishad, Chandam siyatne kratavo viramtani bhutam bhavyam yaccha veda vadanti yasman maistrije vishvam etat tasmin shachanyo mayaya saniruddhaha. So like that he quotes again from Taittiriya Upanishad. Because this entire universe is itself is a gigantic form, which we call as a Virata Rupa. Then Mahaprabhu says, Bhagavan bahu haiteyave kaila mana prakata shakti tabe karila vilokana sekale nahi janme prakrit manona atayeva aprakruta brahmira nitramana. When the Supreme Personality of Godhead wished to become many, he glanced over the material energy. Before the creation, there were no mundane eyes or mind. Therefore, the transcendental nature of the Absolute Truth, mind and eyes, is confirmed. Brahma shabde kahe purna swayam bhagavan, swayam bhagavan krishna shastra praman. The word Brahman indicates complete Supreme Personality of a Godhead, who is Sri Krishna. That is the verdict of the Vedic literature. As in the Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam, like Bhagavad Gita, Lord says that Bahunam Janmanam Ante Jnanavan Nam Padyante Vasudeva Sarvamiti Sa Mahatma Sudurlabha. Sa Mahatma, that great person is rare who sees Lord in each and everything. Because that understanding comes when you get the mercy of the Lord. Otherwise that never happens. Because Mahatma is the term Mahatma is used for them who has taken shelter of the internal potency of the Lord, that is Daivi Prakriti. Mahatmanas tu mam partha Daivi Prakriti Mashrita. The people who has taken shelter of divine potency of the Lord, they are called as the Mahatmas. And once if someone takes shelter of the Lord, then automatically the knowledge that which is needed for him, that gets revealed in his heart. And with that knowledge, he performs the devotional service. The thing is that here Mahaprabhu says that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of the Godhead, and that's what the Vedas says. Then where to find that? What is Brahmana for that? Krishna is the that Brahman. In Bhagavad Gita, the last verse of 14th chapter, Brahmanohi Pratishtaham, Lord says that it's me from whom this Brahman manifests. But in Narayana Upanishad, which is the part of Atharva Veda, there is said, Brahmanyo Devaki Putraha. That Brahman is none other than Devaki Putra, Krishna. So what other evidence do you want? This is Veda Vakya. Even Shripad Shankaracharya, he has wrote one book called Prabodha Sudhakar. It's not very popular actually. Very few people know about that book. And there Shripad Shankaracharya, he explaining that all the attributes are of Brahman are there in Krishna. He has given all the evidences for that in that Prabodha Sudhakar. Very wonderfully, all the like Nirvishesh, Nirakar, all these attributes of Lord. He said they are there with Krishna. And that's why Brahmanyo Devaki Putra. Brahmanyo Madhusudana, Brahmanyo Pundari Kaksha. That's what the Upanishad says. Then further Mahaprabhu says, Vedera Niguda Artha Bhujana Hai Purana Vakya Sei Artha Karaya Nishya. The confidential meaning of the Vedas is not easily understood by common men. Therefore, that meaning is supplemented by the words of Puranas. So why Puranas are given? Because everyone is not that scholarly who can understand the Vedic terminologies. To make them understand that, the same Vedic Siddhanta is given with different analogies, with the stories, and that has put forward, so that even the common man can understand. In the first canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, Vyasadeva himself explains that why he has created Ithyasas and Puranas. He says that because Stri, Vaishya, Tatha, Shudra. Stri, Vaishya and Shudras, they don't have the authority to study Vedas. Then what will happen to with them, you know? Because that's the biggest part of the human community, human society. Stri, Vaishya and Shudra. They are the biggest percentage of human society. Then how they will understand the Vedic teachings? What is there for them? Then he says, Ithyasani Purana. Then he has created this Ithyas and Puranas. Specifically he says, Bharata Puranas. Bharata means Mahabharata, which is considered as Ithyas, and Puranas. Those are given to simplify the Vedic teachings for common people. So now Mahaprabhu says that, okay, if you're not able to understand from the Upanishad Vakyas, let me explain you from Puranas. And then he says, Aho bhagyam, aho bhagyam, nanda gopa vrajaukasam, yan mitram paramanandam, purna brahma sanatanam. So he quotes from? Ten canto, 14 chapter. Those are the prayers offered by Brahma. Brahmaji is saying, Aho Bhagyam. He says, they are so fortunate. Who are those? Nanda Gopa Vraja Upasama. All the Vrajavasis and Nanda Maharaj. See, why he is saying that? Just we have seen that Stri, Vaishya, Tatha, Shudra, they don't have a authority to understand Vedas. But he says, see the Bhagya of whom? Nanda Maharaj, being born in a Vaishya family, but what a fortunate he is. How fortunate he is. That Yan Mitram Paramanandam. Their friend is who? Purna Brahma Sanatana. So whom he is addressing to? He is addressing to Krishna, but what he is calling him? Purna Brahma Sanatana. He is the eternal Brahman, an absolute truth. Okay, you are not able to understand Shruti mantras. Hear from the Puranas. Hear what Brahma says. Who is Brahma? The first person whom the Vedas are revealed in his heart. And that person, he is giving his revelation that that Purna Brahma Sanatana is none other than Krishna. Difficult to understand?
Apani Pada Shruti Varaje Prakrita Pani Charana Punak Kahe Shigra Chale Kare Sarva Grahan.
The Vedic Apani Pada mantra rejects the material hands and legs. Yet it states that the Lord goes very fast and accepts everything offered to him. We are offering bhoga. If he is a impersonal, what's the use of offering him? If he is not able to eat, he does not have a hand, he does not have a mouth. From what all these things?
Okay, Vedic mantra says apani padav. That means he does not have mundane, because mundane things has its own limitations.
Like when you are hearing, you will hear things which are right in front of you, close to you, huh? Or sometimes tuned with your instrument. Only those things you can hear. But Lord, he hears everyone, you know. When you are listening something on your phone, you can't hear what someone is speaking to you. But he hears those things also which are spoken in your mind. That's why his senses are not mundane. There is no limitation for him. Same time, all over the world, everyone is offering aarti to him and he is accepting that. Can we do that? Huh? It's not possible for us. Because we are mundane and our senses are mundane. No? They have limitations. But Lord does not have those limitations.
Then further Mahaprabhu says, Ateva Shruti kahe Brahma Savishesha Mukhya Artha Mukhya Chhadi Lakshana Te Mani Nirvishesha.
All these mantras confirm that the absolute truth is personal. But the Mayavadis, throwing away the direct meaning, interpret the absolute truth as impersonal. So we'll stop here. And next Friday, we'll continue with this wonderful conversation between Sarvam Bhattacharya and Mahaprabhu, where he is proving Sarvam Bhattacharya that Lord is personal, he is not impersonal. So here he is doing Mayavada Khandan. Because Mayavada is considered as the suicidal attempt of Jiva. Not accepting Lord as a person and getting away from the service of the Lord. Service means there is a person. Mayavadis, they don't accept Lord as a person, then where they will render service? And unless and until we serve, our senses are not going to get purified. Neither the consciousness is going to get purified. Or we are not going to get out of this material world. So if you want to get out of this material world, then you should understand that Lord is a person. By serving him, we will purify ourselves. And once we are purified, we will enter to the eternal abode of the Lord, which is Shuddham Vishuddha Sattvam Vasudeva Kalpati. Hare Krishna. Shriman Chaitanya Mahaprabhu ki.